while we're waiting for some other planning board members to show, maybe we'll just run down through the agenda before we start the meeting. I'm just gonna have a quick sort of overview as to what's coming up tonight and some of the things that we will be looking at. Tom Hennessy is coming in, and that will be a public hearing on site plan review. It's a possibility that he could get approval, but I think we need to be wary of the road sketch that has been submitted. We want to look at the traffic very carefully. Mike McGovern called me to alert me to the fact that the 8-foot bikeway on either side of Shore Road is not carried out as it legally should have been to the intersection from the Hennessy's on up to the intersection. So that's something that we have to think about. And Gulfcrest Farms is another public hearing. We will, there are a number of issues there that are outstanding, the cul-de-sac, length of the road, wetlands, and the public, the four lots which are down at the end of the road near Spurwink, according to Tom Leahy, are not allowed to be considered or approved. And so we'll talk about that in full session. Catherine Violette, I hope you've had a chance to go over and visit. And that we should keep strictly to the site plan review in considering this. The zoning board has already determined that the use is all right, and it's our role, our job, to discuss the site plan review. Spinnaker Heights is really coming in not just for final plan review, but for application completeness and probably the issuance of a dated receipt. There are a lot of wetlands, as we heard last time, on that, over 60%. We need to assure ourselves that the soils and the vegetation is well described for us and think about possibly asking for a wetlands alteration permit. John Griffin, a pre-application conference. It's a dry cleaners. I think we have some letters here from the fire chief referring to flammable materials, which is one of the concerns that we might want to address. This is just a pre-application conference, so we will not, this is really an exploratory time. Alan Balfour is coming in for a zone change from an RP to an RA. There is the possibility of a boundary dispute in that area, so we want to make sure that he can give us right title and interest. However, Tom Leahy says that this should not prevent us from discussing it tonight. So I just wanted to let you know about that.
Under other business, the elderly housing.
Yes.
What are we
going to
do?
On the elderly housing, that we will approve and set for a public hearing tonight, hopefully. And there may be some other business, but not much, I hope. Will the meeting of the planning board please come to order? And do we have the minutes of the previous meeting? Did everyone get a copy of those?
No.
I did ask that those be forwarded to us. Perhaps we will have to consider that at the next meeting. So let's run by that one. Jane, do we have the minutes of the previous meeting?
Nope.
All right. Correspondence, you have a number of items in front of you. A letter about Gulfcrest, dated June 16th, 1988, from the fire chief. A letter that from the fire chief also addressing the application for a dry cleaning plant by John Griffin, timed June 17th. A letter from Sharon Coombs, dated 6/19, concerning Mrs. Violette's daycare center on Elmwood Road. A letter from Carl Bernstein, also on the Violette application, dated 6/21/88. A letter from Chief of Police David Pickering on the temporary classrooms, dated June 21st. And a letter from the town manager, Michael McGovern, dated June 21st, as well as from Tom Leahy on Spinnaker Heights dedication and easements. The town council has approved that pending the planning board approval. Is there any other correspondence? If not, our first item of business. No? Okay. Before we get into our old business, there is an item which was on our draft agenda, which does not appear on your present agenda in front of you, and has to do with Elizabeth Farms, the setting of a bond, a letter of credit, and signing of an amended final plan. I would like to first place that at the end of the agenda, but then I would like to ask your permission, if it is all right, to put them on at 8:30, which is where they were on the original agenda, the draft agenda. If that is, does anyone have any objection to that? All right. Our first item then is Tom Hennessy, who is coming in for a site plan review under section 19-2-9. This is a public hearing, and in line with our new policy, I hope that the applicant can keep the presentation to 15 minutes and under so that we can allow plenty of time for all public comment. Mr. Moore, you're representing.
Yes, thank you. I will keep it to less than 7 minutes.
Wonderful.
I am here on behalf of Thomas Hennessy, who is here this evening, as well as Bill Bray, who has prepared the traffic report. Land Use Consultants has been providing the landscape architectural, civil engineering, and on-site surveying services for the project. As the chair has mentioned, Mr. Hennessy is seeking site plan approval this evening for a project which this board looked at last month. Specifically, what Mr. Hennessy is seeking is an approval to convert the existing house, which is the former Murray property, right across the street, into offices for himself in the downstairs floor, and then have a provision for professional offices upstairs and in the other on-site building. The property over 307 Ocean House had been previously occupied as a residence in that Business A zone. So as a part of this proposal, we are considering moving this from an existing non-conforming use into a conforming use for that property. Right now, Mr. Hennessy owns just a little under an acre of property over there, which has frontage on Ocean House Road, approximately 12,000 square feet on Ocean House Road, which includes, or Route 77, which includes the existing house. In addition, Mr. Hennessy owns the fee in the way behind that property, which connects to Scott Dyer Road, and some additional property behind that, which abuts the municipal property on the Scott Dyer Road. What Mr. Hennessy is seeking tonight is approval for conversion of that building to include provision for parking on site, some screening and landscaping, and to widen the existing driveway slightly and provide that parking. Specifically, if I can point to the site plan, the Ocean House Road runs to the east or to the left on this drawing as you look at it. The existing house sits here in the approximate middle of the site with a small existing garage. The Scott Balfour Century 21 building is just immediately alongside that. The private way that is a recorded right-of-way on a plan dating early in the century exists here, and then Mr. Hennessy's additional property sits to the back side. This is the property that I was mentioning in total sum is just under an acre. What is proposed is that the existing driveway in the existing location be left as is, and that additional parking be placed on the level area just alongside the existing driveway, and that two additional spaces be used in the present driveway up to the garage, and that two additional parking spaces be located to the rear of the facility. And the intent on that was to break up the massing, to keep the scale of the parking down, to keep it in scale with the general area, and not to create a large paved section or area immediately in front of the project. And to try and keep this visually as similar to what is out there as is possible. To mitigate any potential off-site impacts, it is proposed on this plan to include 100 linear feet of screen fencing along the southerly property line so that cars coming in and parking are screened and separated from that abutter. And in presenting this plan this way, this provides a minimum visual access to this parking from the traffic out on Ocean House Road in 77. As a part of this proposal, Mr. Hennessy is not intending to expand any of the existing footprint or the building itself. He intends to use that in its present form. The grading on the site will remain as it currently does, which is sloping gently to the back from the rear of the property and then down to the front and out into Ocean House Drive. Based on the stormwater calculations that we had showed, we are proposing no detention because of the extremely modest increase in the runoff. And in addition, the existing utilities that occur on the site will be maintained with the exception of the sanitary sewer. Right now, that facility is served by an existing subsurface disposal system. As shown on the plans, Mr. Hennessy will tie in to the municipal sewer and backfill and abandon the existing field and pull out that existing tank. I think in conclusion, when we had looked at this for a traffic study, Mr. Hennessy had been in some time ago, and the board had expressed some concern over traffic. And that was the one issue that the board had looked at last time and expressed some concern over what was happening with traffic. Bill Gray had prepared or has prepared a traffic impact study which looked at several issues. It looked at the site distance and safety issue of access and egress out of this property, and it looked at impact on this adjacent intersection. As stated in Mr. Bray's report and as shown on our plans, in order to achieve the site distance that the ordinance requires and in fact exceed that, what's required as a part of this project is that a small section of ledge be removed, the section that's out in the right-of-way. We have shown that on drawing 2 of 2. Based on Mr. Bray's recommendation is in his report and based on our observations on the site, we are in fact looking at removing that ledge to achieve the site distance in a southerly direction to get site distance adequate in and out of this existing driveway. In addition to that, in looking at the total trip generations that this project had, in running this out at a full development scenario, Mr. Bray's report indicated that we were looking at a total trip generation of 21 trips. When you net out what existed for the property prior to this proposed conversion, we're really looking at a total increase in trips of approximately 11 trip ends. Based on that and looking at the impact on peak AM and PM traffic, Mr. Bray's report concluded that, in fact, there was no negative impact on the adjacent intersection, and that the traffic in and out of Ocean House Road and the proposed secondary connection out onto the Scott Dyer Road do not propose any hazards with respect to access and egress, nor would they negatively affect those. As a part of this proposal, when Mr. Bray was looking at the traffic in the area, he had indicated through his work that there was a turning accident problem at that intersection. And at the last meeting, we handed out a diagram that showed a proposed striping that Mr. Bray had indicated would be beneficial, that's not going to fit there, would be beneficial to the intersection and help relieve what he indicated as a traffic turning problem. We discussed this with Mr. Hennessy in terms of whether Tom would be willing to pay for those painted markings and improvements as a gesture to the town that he's willing to make some improvements in the area. Tom had indicated he would, and that was the intent behind the presentation of that particular drawing. And if I can describe this in detail, what this is looking at is the creation of a couple of what are known as called turn slots or turn lanes, and that would involve painting lines within Route 77. On this particular plan, the Scott Dyer Road comes in from the bottom. Cumberland Farms property is to the lower left. The Century 21 property is here, and the property that Mr. Hennessy owns sits approximately here. What is looked at here is the creation of a striped lane in the center, and then a tapering of that existing bike lane down as it approaches that intersection to set up the width right at the intersection to get those turning motions. This proposal is not the result of particular impacts that Mr. Hennessy has. Rather, it's something that was suggested by the engineer and Mr. Hennessy has agreed to do. And we have spoken with both the police chief and with Hunter Blue with regard to the adequacy of the plan, and they had no problems. We've looked at it with MDOT as well, and all have indicated that it's really up to the town to make the decision whether that should or should not be in. We offer that to the board. It's at your discretion to either accept that or say that you don't want it. As I understand in conversations with Steve Butler, there's a concern about how that affects the bike lane. Right now, the bicycle lane, as it's striped out in front of us, extends up past and right around the intersection and down Shore Road. That would be affected by this plan in that the bicycle lane would be tapered down as it approached that intersection. This plan does not substantially affect the bike lane on the opposite side of Route 77 because that bike lane currently ends just about in front of Mr. Hennessy's property. It would be tapered slightly as it passed Mr. Hennessy's property and pulled down to 4 feet wide. Certainly. Right now, that bicycle lane ends, for some reason, right here, short of that intersection. In fact, what would happen is we'd taper down beyond, just about to the corner of Century 21, Balfour. That bicycle lane would be lost on this side to create the slot. And again, on this side, that bicycle lane extends right up to
I will have to interrupt here to say that I have talked with the town manager, and it was the intention that that bike lane be maintained all the way to the intersections. That was not intended to be tapered as it currently exists now. So we need to be aware of that in considering this.
Thank you. The effect of this would be to lose that bicycle lane as you approach that intersection for a distance of somewhere between 50 to approximately 160 feet. And I think that's a decision that this board or the council has to deal with in both looking at this project and looking at the accident problem that's there. We are offering it. It's a decision this board can make. And I think with that, that concludes our presentation, and I'd open up to the board for questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to just hold up on the questions if we can, because we do have a public hearing, and I'd like to open that public hearing now and ask if there are any members from the public who would like to speak about this project. If you would you be good enough to come to the microphone and state your name and your address and speak as clearly as possible because we are being recorded. Yes, Mr. Rarr.
My name's Jerry Murray. I'm an abutter, a back abutter, and I've been so for approximately 22 years, I guess. We use that right away, and we have been using it. We and my ex-neighbor have always maintained it, and we've made all the improvements to that right-of-way. And it's a very difficult right-of-way in the respect that There's no real easy way in and out of that intersection at Scott Dyer due to what the state called improvements by putting the directional island at the end of that, perpendicular to that right away. So legally, in talking with the police chief and my neighbors, had many, many ongoing 15-year discussions with the DOT on how we do get egress and egress out of the property. Legally, it's very difficult if you're coming northbound on 77 to get into that intersection, that right away. The only legal way, according to the police chief, is to go down and come up Hill Way, and in that way, or go up and...
Excuse me, what's Hill Way?
Yeah, the old Ocean House Road.
The old,
okay. Yeah. Or go into the library and make a U-turn and come back out and come in that way. The most common way is, as we all have been using, is either a U-turn, which is illegal, coming perpendicular across the face of the island, which we're on our own, the police chief has made that known, or going in behind Dr. McCollum's, which is private property. So I can't really see, and the other thing is, that property for years was a throughway, and the town used to use it periodically, Memorial Days, and to scoop traffic through there, and it was a problem then, and I can't see why it wouldn't be increased with today's traffic. I would hate to see it opened up to throughway. It would be convenient for myself and everybody else, but it's just not a good situation, and I think people would use it on coming out onto Scott Dyer Road, and if the state can't tell us and the chief of police can't tell us, I don't know who's going to tell us the right and the wrong way to come in and out of that that right away. And to increase usage on that would be just a disaster. I can't see how that you could allow that to happen.
Thank you. Questions?
Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
Mr. Murray, I think maybe this is for you, if you wouldn't mind.
I'm sorry. Mr. Murray, I came to the site this afternoon after reading your letter and gained ingress the legal way. I had to go all the way down to Old Ocean House Road and turn around. When I came into this small road, I noticed that it is not very wide. Do you know offhand if it's 10 or 12 feet wide?
Yes, we had it paved at our expense, and it was 10 feet.
10 feet wide, yes. Which is well below the standards.
Yeah, the right-of-way is wider, of course, but the cost of paving was prohibitive.
I also noticed, Mr. Murray, that there is no way of turning around if you took a left-hand turn out of Mr. Hennessy's property by mistake and proceeded the wrong way down that road. There is no turnaround. You just come to a dead end.
You turn around in my driveway.
You have to turn around in private driveway.
And believe it or not, there's a lot of people that mistake that driveway since we had it paved a few years ago as the town library. They come down and they're disoriented, and it's just they turn around in my yard, and,
right.
And I've had a sign up there, but it's just, you know, I think it's a private way, and I would like to see it maintained for
during
safety.
The winter, I would assume that it is not 10 feet wide.
No,
it's
not unless I want to plow it.
Much yeah. less. Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions of Mr. Murray? Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other public comments on Mr. Hennessy's application? If not, we will close the public hearing and open it up for questions from the board and any further presentation that the applicant wants to make or response. Yes, Mr.
If Cross. Mr. Moore would respond to Mr. Murray's statements and to the letter from Police Chief Pickering concerning the issue of access onto Scott Dyer. It was mentioned in a letter that we received to Stephen Butler from Chief Pickering that you were in discussions with him about signs to address the issue. Could you elaborate on that? Or?
Yes, I can.
As I said at the outset of the presentation, The roadway, which is in question here, the driveway, the underlying fee in that rests with Mr. Hennessy and his property. The configuration of Mr. Hennessy's property is such that this elongated street rests in ownership with Mr. Hennessy, and the abutting properties have rights of way over that. They have easements for access and egress. In fact, the pavement on there is 10 feet wide at the rear portion, and then it widens out up at the intersection with the Scott Dyer Road. In looking at the connection of this particular property with that private way, there were several things which guided us in that decision. First and foremost was that, based on the work that we had done and that was done by Bill Bray, we did not find that to be an unsafe or hazardous condition in terms of the connection and the traffic that may come out onto that way. The reason for that is it is extremely difficult, as he has suggested, that to get into that private way from the Scott Dyer Road. And where this property has access from Ocean House Road, clearly the majority of all the turning actions in and out of this property will be from Route 77, because it doesn't make a lot of sense to exit out, to make a right turn onto Scott Dyer, to make a left turn onto Ocean House. And if you're going right or south, then certainly you would come out and exit this way. This is a point of accommodation where the occasional people coming up Scott Dyer Road can turn in and get down and into the property. And that's really what the basis for that design was. In terms of signs that Chief Pickering had talked about, I had delivered a sketch to Chief Pickering based on some concern and comments that the board had raised relative to left-hand turns on Scott Dyer Road and the potential for pedestrian and vehicular conflict. And discussing that with Chief Pickering, our suggestion was to install a right turn only sign either out on the island or to the right hand side. And I think beyond that, I would defer probably to Bill Bray, because he's discussed that issue at length with Chief Pickering.
Is that access necessary for the successful operation of this project?
We feel it is.
Why is that?
In terms of Mr. Hennessy being able to have access, if he's coming up Scott Dyer Road, to come in here in a convenient way, and also to allow for the occasional vehicle which might want to exit and get out over to here. That was felt to be an integral part of the overall plan.
But the main entrance will be signed off Route 77, is that correct?
That is correct.
The
main
that
entrance.
That will be the main entrance.
That is correct.
What are you saying that the viability of the project is jeopardized by not having access over that right away? I guess I...
Tom, would you care to address that?
All I'm saying is I don't mean to get into your finances, but obviously there's a lot of controversy and question that seems to be the issue today. And the answer, frankly, didn't really satisfy at least me that it's entirely necessary. Maybe it is, but there's an obvious solution, and that is to do something about that that exit, unless it's an integral project that we shouldn't.
We believe, in looking at this particular property and Mr. Hennessy's total property, which includes that right-of-way, that is an integral part of the circulation for him to use that property in and out. And in reflecting on that and what we had looked at for traffic impact, when we see no traffic impact from that connection, we felt that that was an appropriate and viable part of this project.
I guess I'd like to ask you, Mr. Hennessy, did you want to comment on that point?
I was just going to point out briefly that with the existing site plan, we do have a couple parking spaces on the back to cut down on parking, the row parking here, rather than put all of our parking here, and in view of the fact that we have a back door here, these two parking spaces here off my private road would provide for easy and low profile access and exit from the back door rather than walking through the reception area. I've been thoroughly in favor of limiting the entrance to this road to eastbound traffic on Scott Dyer Road. It's the only legal way to get in. It's the only sensible way to get into that road and access these two parking spaces. As for exiting, the only possible legal exit is to come out here and take and stop and take a right turn. It's a very convenient, there's no traffic on this one-way portion of Scott Dyer Road between the island and here that you cannot see. You can see a car once you pull up to the pavement on Scott Dyer Road. You can see oncoming traffic, one-way traffic from the west approaching, and wait for it if necessary. If it's not there, it makes for an easy turn out to the intersection with Route 77 and an easy and safe turn south. My other thoughts on the matter are that since the traffic expert has found no danger in using this road properly, I'm more than happy to post it as a right turn only road for exiting. I can't imagine with our signage and main entrance out here the public using this necessarily. It would more likely be myself, my employees, and tenants who might prefer to just come in the way I do when I drive to work, up the old Ocean House Road, stop where the policewoman is posted every morning, and turn left and come right in here one way. Park. It's what I've been doing for the last 14 years as a tenant of Dr. McCullum, and my employees have been doing the same thing, basically parking in this road right of way and on his property here. I don't see it a problem. I can't imagine our going back into the residential section of the neighborhood. And my feelings, honestly, as a property owner, are that this is a road. This is a roadway that it's land that I own. It's land that I bought, and for a purpose. I have road. If you want to consider it, you know, private road. I have 119 feet of road frontage on it that could be, you know, that I feel that I should be able to use. I own it, and I have more rights in this road than anyone else who uses it. There is a right-of-way to the back portion of the McCullum property, a right-of-way over this, subject to rights of others. Mr. Murray has a right-of-way, and the John Griffin property has a right-of-way, but no ownership of it. It would seem to me unfair, and I'm biased, that persons having, and these are commercial uses, existing business uses in a business zone, the dentist office and the office tenants are using this for business purposes. Mr. Murray uses it for business purposes, and there is at least a proposal by this abutter, Mr. Griffin, to make partial commercial use or business use of his property. Not through the right-of-way, because he proposes a driveway here. It seems unfair to me that everyone else can continue to use my private road right-of-way, but I should not be allowed to use it in the very limited way that I'd like to.
What has been your personal experience, having lived there for 14 years, or your own personal observation about cars being illegal about that use?
I know that it has happened. We do see, I sit right here in this building of Dr. McCullum's and look right out at the private road we're talking about and at the intersection. I've seen some accidents out here, but not in front of this road. There are accidents that have happened.
But you've seen illegal turnings and so forth.
Occasionally, yes. Yeah. But the visibility is so good, and I don't encourage these illegal turns. And I think, in all the time I've been there as a tenant, 13 or 14 years, it's never been posted right turn only. It's common sense that it would be ludicrous to turn left on what's clearly a one-way street at what might become oncoming traffic and no escape, pavement on either, curbs on either side. I've yet to see an accident out there. We get very little pedestrian traffic. There is virtually no pedestrian traffic other than butters on the road itself. It leads nowhere. And there's virtually no pedestrian traffic across these properties at all. People use the sidewalk. When on the sidewalk, they're plainly visible.
I think Mr. Butler has a question he'd like to ask.
I just have a point. I just want to bring out that the police chief did raise a very strong concern about the use of that roadway in and out. And there have been several instances where people, however ludicrous, have tried to access it going one way and then exiting, leaving out in a westerly direction along Scott Dyer Road. In fact, this past weekend, I don't know who it was, but I witnessed two people going in a westerly direction the wrong way. So it is an issue that I think needs to be looked at by the board. And at a minimum, I might suggest that the whatever plans that the applicant might suggest for minimizing those problems be reviewed and approved by the police chief.
Yes, Mrs. Guthrie.
Madam Chairman. I certainly sympathize with you. You do own the fee in the road, and I don't doubt your ownership. However, if that is going to be used for business purposes, as far as I'm concerned, the road is far too narrow. And we just have standards for roads and subdivisions, et cetera, that have to be wider. And so I certainly couldn't agree to that until I knew that the police chief okayed it, that the proper signage was there, and also I would like to see an improvement in the width of that road. If you plan to use it on a regular basis, mm-hmm. I certainly wouldn't say to you that you should widen the road and go through all of that expense if you and your tenant were going to use that road exclusively and use the two parking spaces. But once I think that other people, clients of yours, are going to be using that, then I would have to say that that has to be widened substantially.
There is the right-of-way width is 35 feet, and there's adequate width to triple the width of the road if necessary. But as a practical matter, at what is viewed to be the critical area here, perhaps it's paved. I've measured it in this area through here. It varies somewhat, but I found 11 to 13 feet in many places here. And as soon as for the full width of Dr. McCullum's building, which sets back from the property line somewhat, starts at about the sidewalk, which is maybe, I don't know where that is, maybe 6 feet back from the property line or 3 feet. His building goes back 50 feet, roughly. And the pavement runs all the way from the center right over to his building. So there is a wider than 12 or 13 foot section here that extends 50 feet back, or say 55 or 60 feet back from Scott Dyer Road.
Mm-hmm.
And
I saw
wide
that
enough
today.
For two cars to pass.
Right.
And that's what most of the current traffic is there around the building. And I would agree that that to use it further, that at least, if not paving, there should at least be crushed rock shoulders that would be, that would appear to be, that, that could function as paving or emergency paving in case of the need for two cars to pass safely.
Could we go to another topic on your application, and that's the site distance that as you exit from Route 77, onto Route 77. I just stopped there the other day on a jog and took a look both ways, and it's very inhibiting. As you look around the curves, there's a maple tree on one side and takes up, obscures your vision. And the mailboxes on the other side seem to block. What are your thoughts about that and achieving a good sight distance? I know that the police chief said that perhaps 38 feet could be forgiven, but I wonder as I look at that. Would you come to the podium, please, and identify yourself and the...
Yes, my name is Bill Bray. I'm the traffic engineer working on the project. As Mr. Moore had indicated in the report that I prepared for Mr. Hennessy, I had indicated in order to meet the town's minimum standards for vehicle sight lines to the right of the driveway, a portion of the existing ledge outcropping, roughly 100 to 150 feet southerly of the driveway, would have to be removed.
Has some of that already been removed?
It looks like someone may have been out there picking away at it, but it certainly needs
major heatfalls.
It's considerably more needs to be removed than what has been removed. Once that has been removed to a point roughly equal to where the property line is, one could achieve a sight distance line of over 400 feet measured from a point that actually exceeds the town standards, at least as defined in the town standards. Looking to the left of the driveway, looking left from the driveway, again exceeding what has been determined to be the measuring point by the town standards, again you would achieve sight distance that exceed the minimum standards, again, as pointed out in the town standards. And to the left, there are no obstructions because you are actually in front of the two large maple trees that abut the driveway. So there is adequate sight distance looking both left and right, providing the ledge outcropping is removed as recommended in the report.
Thank you. Any questions? Yes, Mr.
Madam
Butler.
Chairman, I just want to point out and maybe ask for Mr. Bray's clarification or comments on a letter that was submitted by Patrolman Dyer that talks about in which Mr. Dyer went out and examined the sight distance situation and noticed the ledge, but also noticed the fact that there appeared to be a problem with respect to the positioning of the mailboxes and, as he put it, a clump of trees.
According to the town standards, and reviewing those standards with, I believe, the town's engineer, T.Y. Lynn Hunter Ballou, when an obstruction such as, in this case, a 28-inch maple tree is in the line of sight, one can take the measure point for that sight distance, a distance of 10 feet back from the edge of the travel way. The travel way is defined as the white edge line on the pavement, or also referred to as the bike lane, and measuring that to the curb is 8 feet, and if you come in another 2 feet, you can actually at that point achieve something in excess of 400 feet. The measurement that I took was actually 18 feet instead of the 10 feet that was is the minimum standard in the town ordinance. So again, if you use the minimum standards, the sight distance clearly exceeds those. And if you go back to the point that I've indicated, you still can achieve a sight distance greater than what the minimum standards of 385 feet is.
Any other questions? Comments? I wonder if the board wants to consider having the police chief take a an actual estimate of what the speed limit is going by that area for further information. Yes.
Again, the town's standards state that if the speed limit, whatever the posted speed limit is, in this case 35 miles per hour, if vehicle speed measurements are not available at a sufficient quantity to provide accurate data, then one is to assume the sight distance is 110% of that posted speed limit, which in this case would be 385 feet. And again, in both cases, to the left and the right of the driveway, the sight distance that I measured and am recommending exceeds that minimum standard.
Now, I appreciate what you're saying.
Madam Chairman, just to follow up on that, given the board's concern about sight distance, the police department had been asked and was thought that they might be able to do a speed check for tonight's meeting. I wasn't able to confirm whether or not that had occurred with the police chief, so can't report on that progress.
Any further questions or comments?
Madam Chairman, yes. I have a couple of comments, and then a question of Mr. Hennessy. The first is that we don't, if there is an approval given, that we don't condition the approval on the striking of 77. I think that this board isn't the right board to require or to allow the taking away of a bike path, change the characteristics of a bike path, or change the characteristics of an intersection directly to the client. The suggestion may be appropriate, as indicated by Mr. Hunter, and it probably is, but that's something that the town council should consider. And it's a nice gesture on the part of the applicant to offer to do that, but I don't think we should require or condition it or allow it to happen as a part of the approval of the site plan review. I guess the second comment on the site distance is T.Y. Lynn has indicated that appropriate site distances are provided, I believe, and one of the conditions that we have, at least in the drafted motion, is that those be approved by the town engineer, which presumably means that all of the improvements are done as we're suggesting to the town engineer. And maybe we want some language in there that says the site distances are cleared as presented in the application and that they be reviewed and approved by the town engineer. Second issue relates to the entrance and exit on Skyback Road. And it's been indicated that by both neighbors and some concern by members of the planning board that it's a highly constrained situation at the very least. And maybe my question to Mr. Hennessy is that if the planning board approved the site plan basically as configured, that did not allow client use of that owned piece of land that others use as a right-of-way. We already have one residence and a business in that residence, in Mr. Murray's place. We have an application later that is going to be, again, using that right-of-way for the dry cleaning business, but not for client use for the dry cleaning business, presumably for those that live there or work there. And maybe we should be doing the same thing. Mr. Henderson's saying it is his land. He can use it for his own entrance and even his employee entrance and exit. But there'd be a physical barrier of separation between client use of his property and those that work there or live there or are tenants there, however that's done. And I guess that's the question I have, Mr. Hennessy, whether the use of that piece of land is so critical in his client's use that it makes the deal untenable or proposed use untenable, or whether that's an acceptable alternative.
Mr. Hennessy, do you want to respond to that?
Yes, and I'll respond to the last first because it's fresh on our minds on the issue of client use of the private road right away. I like Mr. Kinsman's suggestion. It's something that I would be willing to go along with. It was never my intent that clients or visitors use the parking spaces to the rear, or that they use the other than 77. But I would like to reserve, as he's mentioned, the use of private road for myself, employees, and tenants of the property, but not clients. On the other, perhaps you could just refresh me on the other questions, just briefly.
I have to play back the tape. That was the only question that I had.
Okay.
The other comments and feelings about particular issues within the application. If that's the case, and hearing a positive response, I would suggest that if we do move to approve this, that we condition, as a second condition, that a physical barrier be placed between the client use of the parking lot and its right of way, so that clients aren't prone to use it, and that physical barrier is in shrubs or grass or trees as currently exist, however that's appropriate.
A good suggestion. How do other members of the planning board feel? Is this agreeable or amenable that way?
Yes.
So I think we're clearing up perhaps some issues here. Might be ready to.
Do we have a fast draft
from sure my do. Left
sure.
of a potential motion?
One question I might ask of the board is whether or not you want to address, as perhaps a condition of approval, the whole with Mr. Tinsman suggested condition. Do you want to still address the fact that signage on the roadway entering Scottsdale Road in terms of having something that would kind of clearly and expressly indicate that left-hand turns are not allowed at that point, or if you feel that's not necessary at this point?
I think that probably would be a good idea to include that.
Okay. So with that, I'll read a revised suggested motion, and we'll see how it sounds. Be it ordered that the planning board finds the proposed office building conversion as proposed by Thomas Hennessy III, which is located along Route 77, meets the standards contained in Section 19-2-9 sub C of the zoning ordinance, and therefore grants site plan approval for the proposed project in accordance with Section 19-2-9, comma, the facts presented and the following conditions. A, that the site distances be reviewed and approved by the town engineer after the removal of the ledge and prior to the property's use as an office. B, that a physical barrier be placed between the applicant's parking lot and the private driveway. And C,
is it assumed that we would still have a no left turn? I think we were thinking about that before, but it seems to me it still makes sense.
That's C coming up. Sorry. C, that an access and signage plan for the roadway that enters Scottsdale Road be reviewed and approved by the police chief prior to the property's use as an office. That would be it.
So moved.
It has been moved. Is there a second?
Is it implicit in what we're doing that we are rejecting the striping and reduction of the bike path? There was some discussion of bucking that on to some higher authority.
I'd like us
to be on record. I assume we don't want the striping or the bike path.
I think that, as Dick pointed out, is really more properly under the authority of the town council to deal with town roads. So I don't think that we do enter into that, other than that our minutes will reflect the encouragement of addressing the situation.
Is that what we want? Or I guess my question with Mr. Hennessy is, if this is passed, would you of your own go to the town council and ask to do the striping?
I'd be content to drop the issue. I had no idea when it was suggested that it would become a problem area. It was simply a gesture to the town in good faith
I now realize that there are other issues involved, and I'd rather simply have us, you know, strike it from our application package.
Then I wouldn't think we'd want to refer it to someone else. I mean, you want to drop
it? No, I think that the town would address that. And would be aware of this sensitive spot. Is there any other discussion?
Just could you run it by us again on B, what you read, that a physical barrier be placed
between the applicant's parking lot and the private roadway, which I don't believe has a name.
Madam Chairman, maybe that could be revised, not to belabor the point. This has been quite a while on it. But just indicating physical barrier be placed there, not allowing client use of
right.
the private road for the purposes of the business.
Is that amendment agreeable to the
yes.
seconder?
Yeah.
And the maker of the motion. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion as amended, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Mr. Box, are you voting?
Oh,
it is unanimous. Thank you, and you do have your permit to go ahead, Mr. Hennessy, and thank you for your helpful information. Our next item of business is Gulfcrest Farms, a public hearing also on a major subdivision of 34 lots under Section 16-2-4. And also discussion of an alteration of a wetlands permit under Section 16-2-3. Good evening, Mr. Bruce, and this is a public hearing, so I would like to open it before you make your presentation and hope that we can keep to a crisp 15 minutes in order to contain the public hearing in the time frame that we've ambitiously set up.
I think I can accomplish that.
The public hearing will now open, and Mr. Bruce is representing Gulfcrest Farms and will make a presentation.
Thank you. The ordinance says that the applicant shall be prepared to respond fully to questions by the public and by the board. And in order to meet this responsibility, we have with us tonight John Lorty, our wildlife biologist, Albert Frick, soil scientist and site evaluator, who's also responsible for all the septic systems, and our team from Whitman and Howard, Roland Levesque, Jim Wendell, and a new entry, Dana Levitt, who did the landscaping plans that have been submitted to the board. Briefly, just want to mention some housekeeping details, and that is that some of our papers that have been filed and before the board may be altered. For example, in the deed to the trust, the town manager has indicated some language that he would prefer to have in the deed, and we'll be making a substitute filing of that. Our declaration, we will be amending pursuant to certain suggestions by Mr. Lorty concerning restrictions on some of the lots to facilitate the deer and the use of the property by deer and other wildlife. And we may be placing some additional restrictions on the lots to prohibit any filling or dredging under DEP rules. And I expect that as we go along, we've just filed a big package with the DEP, things will be changing, and pursuant to Mr. Butler's request, all of that filing will be done on the filing day rather than come in piecemeal, so it will be distributed in your monthly package. Also, we've been asked by the Portland Water District to extend the water line for better pressure out to Fowler Road, and we expect to do that over the easement that Mr. Chavanel will be giving us. Mr. Chavanel, and he has no objection to our putting the water line in the road. You mentioned the alteration of wetlands permit. We still have some additional studies, water runoff quality, groundwater studies, and the like, and those will be filed on the filing day this coming month, on the 1st. And some of those are supplemental studies. I don't know whether they're viewed by the board as supplemental or essential to a declaration of completeness, but that might be something we can consider after this public hearing. I see a lot of familiar faces, and I won't take up the time of everyone to summarize the project, except in response to a specific question of somebody who may not be familiar with it.
Thank you, Mr. Bruce. Are there any members of the public that would like to comment, ask questions? And if so, if you would come forward to the microphone, say your name and address, and also try to speak very clearly. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the board, my name is John Roberts. I live at 185 Fowler Road, and I am both an abutter and a concerned resident. As many of you are aware, the Gulfcrest development will be situated a good distance from my home, and during summer months will hardly be visible. I have never entertained any delusions that this land would not be developed, and I hope my comments will be looked upon as not strictly self-serving. My concern is genuine. I am a paid member of the World Wildlife Fund, the National Arbor Society, the National Geographic Society, and the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. I was responsible for having Dr. Rand speak to the South Portland Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club, and in turn managed to have $1,000 contributed to the trust by the Rotary Club when the Land Trust was first starting up. Now to address my concerns. The vast acres of fields that will be turned into 34 neat little lawns called Gulfcrest Farms will inevitably displace hundreds of families, families of meadowlarks, bobolinks, nighthawks, song sparrows, finches, pheasants, and many, many more. Such is the price of progress. Since the town never saw fit to acquire this property through bond or other means, it is now up to this board to see that the developer's shovel does not totally destroy this unique habitat, and that some of the accommodation be given to maintaining as much of the land as possible for native wildlife. Don't be deluded into thinking that this proposal is the greatest thing since sliced bread. It isn't. The fact of the matter is that with the sheer size of this property, much more could be preserved than is being proposed, and yet still give the developers a handsome profit. Much of the acreage proposed for development by Brown Homes is located in or around sensitive wetland. Not all of the unsuitable soils are confined to the margins of the property. How does the developer propose to solve this problem? One way he is suggesting is to pipe sewage from lots too wet to sustain their own septic systems to community tanks located hundreds of feet away on small islands of dry soil. Both of these sites are located extremely close to the unmistakable wetland that leads to the Spurwink Estuary. This board, on your recent site walk, witnessed only a small portion of the wet areas. Yet, considering how little rain we have had prior to your visit, it is still possible to get a sense of just how wet many of the areas were. Much of the plant life you observed is indigenous to only wetland. The time did not permit your walking along the drainage route off the southern end of the property. Neither did your footwear. Considering the scope and magnitude of this proposal, this board needs to insist that an intensive identification and mapping of all the wetland be done, both by soil type and by plant type. Further, an impact study should be required to see what steps can be taken to minimize the displacement of the wildlife that will occur. As to the possibility of an access road to Fowler Road, I will argue against this before this board and, if necessary, before the DEP. My opposition to this has been detailed to you previously on a communication dated April 29. To restate briefly, a road would become a major throughway for traffic going to the dump from all of Shore Acres, Weathersfield, and Fowler Road, and this will have a tremendous negative effect on the wildlife corridor that now exists between the wetlands of Pollock Brook to the Spurwink Estuary. In summary, I feel that the developer needs to demonstrate what impact the proposal will have on wildlife and how it can be minimized. The town must insist that each lot be capable of handling its own waste discharge without piping cross-country to the edge of wetlands and adjoining properties. And it must be absolutely certain that wetlands are not being altered by improper development. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. And we do have a copy of your remarks to put into the record.
Thank you.
Mr. Bruce, did you want to respond to any of those comments?
If that is the correct procedure, I'll do it, and I'll try to be brief. Mr. Roberts has been a participant from the beginning, and I have great respect for his observations. We will be submitting a complete vegetative analysis, and that will be something that will be reviewed by this board in connection with our wetlands application and, of course, by the DEP. But I would say that with respect to the off-site septic systems, those are being done strictly in accordance with the law. We're observing all of the requirements of the law, of the sewer ordinance, and Article 3 of the sewer ordinance, which spells out how it must be done technically. And I have submitted a summary of that to the board, and I think that you have that before you. Also, Mr. Lordy is here tonight, John Lordy, wildlife biologist, and he wrote us a letter earlier, which you have, and now we have his complete report, and he has addressed many of the concerns that Mr. Roberts has raised. So if you'd like to hear from Mr. Lordy for a brief description of
Very briefly address perhaps some of Mr. Roberts' concerns about the wildlife, such as the song sparrows, the meadowlarks, and as well as the deer, I think that would be helpful.
I noticed that there are yellow-bellied flycatchers there as well, because we have...
Is that endangered?
I don't think it's endangered by our project, and I hope that's what Mr. Lordy will tell you, although he has made some recommendations that we will act upon as far as on certain lots having restrictions against any alteration of the landscape and so on, and we will respond to those.
Be brief.
Do you want to just identify yourself and what firm you're from?
John Lordy. I'm a wildlife biologist with Woodlot Alternatives. My primary responsibility when I was approached by Whitman and Howard about this project was to review how the project was going to affect deer travel corridors, and specifically, would the project restrict deer from using any of the property up here or any of the property up here or, you know, any of the adjacent areas that they frequent quite a bit? So that was what my primary emphasis was, and that's what I mainly looked at. I conducted two site visits, one with most of the people here, and then I went out last Saturday and spent most of the day there myself because I wanted to get a little bit better feel for what's out there. When I did go out to the site, what I wanted to first identify was where are the major deer use areas on the property. So basically I walked throughout the whole thing, and while I was in the field I took notes. You can identify high use deer areas by areas that are trampled, areas that contain pellet accumulations, areas that are heavily browsed. Those are your three best indicators. So I looked for those features. I identified them on the site in relation to where the development was going to occur, and I overlaid them, and that will be presented to you in a report. And I guess to be brief, and I can elaborate if there are questions, I think the most, the area that concerns me the most with this project is just this narrow band of property right here and this proposed connection route to Fowler Road. As far as the deer are concerned, as far as maintaining a travel corridor between this property, which is heavily used, and between this property, that road would cause some major problems as far as the deer are concerned. It would be a very bad thing to do if you are interested in maintaining a travel corridor. The areas on the property that I did find that were heavily used tended to be the wetland areas and the riparian zones directly adjacent to them. And I guess it's hard to use my pointer here, but this is most of the wetland, the boggy marsh type area. There was three main trails that cut across here going into this piece of woods from this zone here. Okay, this zone that I pointed to right here tend to be dominated by alders and a lot of young popples. Okay, the deer were in there quite heavily. And that was the area where the fields are slightly raised. You go down over a little bit of a berm, and it's very dense vegetation. And then you get into your marshy bog area. They were in that area quite a bit. They were primarily migrating through the vegetation in here, staying mostly out of the open areas, coming down through the trees off of the Gulf Crest Farm property onto this property here and moving back across this way. Deer generally tend to, they like a little cover when they move through areas, and they won't go out in the open. They'll be 10 or 15 feet into the edge of the woods, and they'll use those areas pretty extensively, but they generally won't be out in the field. They come out in the fields to feed quite a bit, and they'll use them extensively at night. The way that this project is laid out, I did not have a lot of, as far as deer are concerned, the high use areas are not being proposed to be developed. Like I say, the areas that I found to be heavily used were here. And I did not find any areas on the property that I considered to be really heavily used. Okay, I was actually a little bit surprised at the lack of a real density of deer sign in some areas. Because my brother-in-law lives on Fowler Road, and have known several people live here. I know there's a lot of deer there, but they're not concentrating up. And that means two things to me. That means that they have a lot of available habitat, and it means that there's room for expansion for the deer herd. So that doesn't seem to be threatened. But these back lots here, because this property here, all of the abutting property owners on Fowler Road do not have any deed restrictions in their lots, they could essentially go in and completely clear the vegetation. If they went in and completely wiped out the area that the deer are using real heavily right now, this rear portion of the Gull Crest property would become more important. As it sits right now, you can see most of this piece of property right here in the funnel area, if you want to call it that, is primarily in a field system. Okay, deer would be less apt to use it. If all this area was wiped out and this was still in a field system, you would probably ruin your travel corridor through there. Okay, so there's a couple things that I have suggested that are in the report dealing with if these lots are ever developed, types of restrictions on vegetation manipulation and things like that. So.
Fine. Thank you very much, yeah. Mr. Lord. Are there other members of the public that would like to comment on Gullcrest? I guess, maybe the man from the rear got up first.
I'm Ray Chevenel. My wife and I own the fee simple interest in the strip of land that is at the southerly portion. Could I move this map down just for a moment? We own the fee of this strip of land from the end of the large land area to Fowler Road. You said this public hearing was to entertain questions as well as comments. I'd like to ask a couple of questions, and then I'll make a couple of very brief comments. The questions are, could the developer just review quickly their plans for access to this property? Where is the street going to be, and what is the plan for this strip here?
Mr. Bruce.
pursuant to an agreement with the town, we have right-of-way over town land here out to the Skerwick Avenue, and that would be the main entrance to the Gulfcrest Farm community. Our proposal, essentially, is to bring the road down to a cul-de-sac, to a turnaround here, and then later on when these last lots are developed, when we bring them to a cul-de-sac here. Pursuant to, again, to a suggestion by the board that it would be advisable to have at least emergency access from here on out to Fowler Road, our proposal is to have access from this point out to Fowler Road on an emergency basis only, and the easement that you see in your package gives us an easement for plowing that road as well. We would undertake to keep that plowed, and the association that would, the homeowners would also keep that road plowed from wherever the end of the accepted road was down through. So it would be the limited access. In addition, there would be a green belt access over Mr. Chevenel's right-of-way or property on the right-of-way to that would connect up to the green
belt. So that would be public access?
That would be public access over a 15-foot strip that would be designated essentially as a green belt access. It would be non-vehicular pedestrian access, no RCB, pedestrians, I suppose, possibly skiers, and I think that would be non-vehicular, but no machinery of any kind.
Mr. Chevenel, did you have another? Does that answer that question?
Yes,
That answers my question. A few comments. Diane and I have been to all, well, I've been to all the meetings. Diane's been to many of them. I've been on the site walks. This has been somewhat of a thicket, literally and figuratively, for us to walk through. At first, we didn't want anything to spoil the privacy and the quiet and all the deer, and believe me, there are lots of them, and they travel through there mostly early in the morning and at dusk or just a little after dusk. You rarely see deer there in the day, but it's a beautiful spot. We finally, after all of the discussions, have agreed that this strip is a very special strip, and so we do think that the green belt idea is something that we can live with. One of my points right now is we have not signed any agreements at this point. There's nothing. The conservation agreement, the easement deed, none of those have been signed. Diane and I plan to. There's no question about changing our mind. The only thing that we're still concerned with that we have been all along is that our interests be protected, and there are some things we've got to negotiate about that strip. I'll indicate a couple of them. Right now, our power, our telephone, and our cable TV lines are buried right under the strip that's being considered for the greenbelt. We think those ought to be relocated. So that's one of the things we've got to work out. Right now we have a fence. It's a small fence that effectively, it's right at the Fowler Road, and it, in effect, it's a barrier over the greenbelt proposed strip. In the green belt, or in the conservation agreement, it says that no man-made structures or barriers can exist, so we've got to remove that and figure out how to do it. So there are some practical considerations. Diane and I hope that they do not scuttle this. We want to, in a spirit of neighborliness, want to work this thing out. Just in passing, I'd like to say that if things change as you deliberate, Jack Roberts, would oppose changing that strip into a full-fledged street. We think it's totally unnecessary as the plan has been put together. I'd be happy to answer any other questions. Those are my comments for now.
Thank you, Mr. Chevenel. Any questions from board members? Are there some other members of the public that would like to speak about Gullcrest? Yes.
My name is Claire Brosnan, and I live at 187 Fowler Road. And my property is just to the left, to the right, as you go in from Fowler Road on Ray's Road. Anything that happens to that road, although Ray owns the road, directly affects me because my property abuts that road and it abuts this development on the back. I would not be in favor of that ever becoming a full-fledged road. We bought the property because we enjoyed the openness, we enjoyed the animals, the wildlife that we find there. We've always enjoyed them. We would hate to see that become a major road. I would be strongly opposed to any major access to this development originating at Fowler Road. I also see it as inevitably, if it should be, and I understand that he has said that the major access is going to be from Spurwink, but nothing's definite yet. It would be a major road for people going to the dump. We would be forced to do something to our property then to ensure our privacy. So whatever is done to that road affects us directly also.
Thank you, Mrs. Brosnan. Any other members of the public?
Hello, I'm Peter Monroe. I live at 54 Old Colony Lane in Cape Elizabeth. Unlike others here, I'm not directly in a butter. I'm here as a concerned resident of the town. I believe there are some townwide issues which are being addressed by this development or potential development, and that's why I'm here. I'm also a member of the Maine Association of Planners and the Maine section of the American Society of Landscape Architects. After I have been down to town hall here and reviewed the documents that had been on file until this week, in any case, I understand there are more now. And after reviewing them and other documents filed previously, I would suggest that there are three major areas of concern that I have. First, that the best interest of the town and its residents would be served by there being no development here, by this being retained as open space, and that any consideration of this particular development proposal ought to be made in that light, and that there are others who concur in that point of view. Second, that the proposal of Brown Homes as presented tonight, as best we know of it from the documents we have had, is insufficient to determine how seriously town interests are being affected, particularly as they relate to wetlands and wildlife. And more documents should be requested, documents which have not been yet mentioned tonight. I understand John Lordy has filed a wildlife report or will soon, but there are other documents which I think are required, and I'll mention them in a moment. And third, to the extent that they can be determined from the documents which are already here, the proposal will create potential threats to the town health and safety, which should be considered unacceptable. And inasmuch, I would hope that the planning board would ask that revisions be made of this proposal. First, concerning retaining this area as open space, I have filed with you a memo on May 3rd, which contained my seven major arguments for that. They were that it is a scenic area as defined by the only scenic map of town, and that scenic areas are one consideration that the planning board should use in making decisions about subdivision proposals. That's item H in section 16.1.1 of the subdivision ordinance. Second, that it is not actively farmed, but it is open as farmland, which residents have said they want preserved. It is indeed part of the Greenbelt plan, and there must be at least a minimal public access through there, but this would be a perfect area to have more than merely a 15-foot corridor. that it is a backyard to populous Cape neighborhoods which lack a neighborhood park. It is part of the headwaters of the Spurwick Marsh, which both local and other authorities believe should be preserved and protected. Wildlife regularly use it, as has already been mentioned, and that it is a missing link in town-owned land at the center of Cape. The town owns the parcels both to the east and to the west, and with the land trust owns areas to the north as well. The federal government agrees that this land should be protected, and on the back of the copies I've just given you, a copy of a June 7, 1988 letter from Robert L. Miller, the senior staff specialist in the Office of Realty of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service out of Newton Corner, Massachusetts. At my request, they came up and visited Gullcrest Farm, and they wrote that they will specify in a draft environmental assessment, which they will release next month, quote, approximately 65 acres in the eastern portion of the 110-acre Gullcrest Farm have been identified for proposed service acquisition as part of the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge. The identified acreage includes freshwater wetlands and approximately 150 feet of protective critical edge uplands adjacent to the marsh. He adds in another paragraph, Gullcrest Farm is an excellent candidate for a cooperative local, private, and federal effort to protect important wildlife habitat and to preserve valuable open space. The service, meaning the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, would acquire the wetland portion and associated critical edge, while the remainder of the farm could be protected by private and or local interests, unquote. The second point is that in order to understand the true impacts on things that affect townwide interests here, other documents are needed. First, a full site development plan should be presented, which includes all wetland impacts. By looking at various plans which you have, particularly sheet 8 of 24, which I believe is called Inland Wetland Soils, that is the only wetland impact map that I was able to locate. It shows only hydric soils, lot lines, and rights of way. However, missing are storm detention basins, sewage lines, road pavement, house and driveway locations, and ponding areas. Ponding areas are specifically mentioned on the pre-development watershed map. Those areas lie around the community septic systems in the lower part of the site. The storm detention areas, which in some cases are very large, there's one that's more than 250 feet long behind lots 27 and 33. And those are not shown on this hydric soils map either. But my attempts to overlay the storm detention areas with the wetland map gives me an idea that particular detention basin may in fact impact Sebago Monkey Peat areas in the Resource Protection District. It seems to me that the Resource Protection District should be free of such alterations and that we ought to have a plan which shows exactly the extent of these wetland impacts. That'll become more critical in comments I'll make in just a minute. And that is that before we grant approval for this project, and in fact, I would have suggested even before this hearing, the results of an Army Corps of Engineer review of this project ought to be available. The reason I suggest that is that if the wetland impacts are as great as I suspect they are, and again, I don't have the documents to see exactly how extensive they are, but if they are as extensive as they seem to be, for example, the right-of-way contains 73,000 square feet in hydric soils. That's almost 2 acres just of right-of-way. The Corps gets very interested in proposals once the impact goes over 1 acre of wetland alteration. I suggest that Jay Clement, the Corps' man in Maine, will request serious alterations of this proposal in order to minimize wetland impact, and that as a result, a revised subdivision plan will be brought back in here. And I hope that the board will remember my request that another hearing be held if this proposal is indeed altered significantly to minimize wetland impact. In other words, I think the public ought to have a right to be able to comment on a plan which first minimizes wetland impact and is a plan which can be built. I don't believe this plan is such a plan. Finally, I believe that there are revisions which the board might request to assure public health and safety. First of all, in a biggest context, I'd like to say that usually Wetland impacts are allowed by federal and other authorities if it meets three tests. First, that it helps meet a clearly defined public need. Second, that there is no practical alternative. And third, that all possible mitigation measures have been taken to avoid this wetland impact. And I would say that this proposal tonight meets none of those tests. It does not meet a clearly demonstrated public need. There are practical alternatives, and all possible mitigation has not been attempted. With that in mind, I'd like to make four specific suggestions for revisions be considered by your board. First, that the road connection to Fowler Road be eliminated. As has been suggested by John Lordy tonight, that road would, quote, cause major problems, unquote, with the deer travel corridor. Furthermore, it goes through what is clearly wetland. I believe Peter Rand has pointed out that there's some dispute in this area over what exactly is wetland, but that the town maps of wetlands on the Fowler Road side are clearly inaccurate based on the amount of water we encountered when we tried to walk around down there. This road, the extension that everyone's talked about, is to provide an emergency secondary access to this project. I suggest there are two alternatives that the board can consider. The first is, if such an emergency secondary access is in fact required, that it might be made on dry land up into the dump, or the transfer station, if you will. The town has granted the first access by widening the access onto Spurwink Avenue. It seems to me that the town could not only be in a position, but might consider it reasonable to provide the second necessary access without impacting wetland. Second of all, the other possibility is that your board could approve a plan, at least conceptually, that was what the original plan that was presented here contained, which is an access drive of 1,000 feet or less that leads to a loop. So there are two accesses to every home except for a length of 1,000 feet or less. That would meet the test of the subdivision ordinance, which says that cul-de-sac shall not exceed 1,000 feet with a variance. I believe that's how it goes. The idea being that the longer single access to houses is, the more dangerous it becomes. But the first plan that was presented here was rejected not because of that road layout, but because it was a maximum development scheme that had something upwards of 40 lots that went down into the wetlands and so forth. I suggest that this kind of a cluster scheme on a loop with a short access drive would meet the safety requirements and avoid the wetland impacts and the wildlife impacts that we're trying to avoid. Second suggestion is, and I heard you, Alice, make a reference to this in opening the meeting, that I suggest that the board consider removing the four proposed lots that would require future town sewer connections. And if I understood you correctly, Thomas Leahy said those could not even be considered. Does that mean they're eliminated?
We have been advised that those cannot be approved by the planning board because they are not within reach of the sewer, and it is just not legal for us to consider them.
And what would it mean then if you approved the proposal with only 34 lots? Would it mean they could come back at some future time if the sewer ordinance were changed?
Could not draw the lots as such because they're not. There's no septic for them.
I understand that, but could the developer retain the land that's involved in those four lots and at some future time come back and say we would like to now subdivide based on a revised sewer ordinance?
If the sewer came along, but that's not likely.
I would suggest or hope that you would pass a sense of the board that you were opposed to ever allowing four lots in those locations. I guess that's my suggestion. My third suggestion is that the board should require removing of all storm detention basins from hydric soils. And I believe this very large storm detention basin, which I referred to, which is located out in this area, Sebago Muckie Peat, mind you, and the Resource Protection District is up in this area. A very large storm water detention basin. I think it's close to an acre. I'm sure the engineers can give me an exact square footage on it. It is up to 10 feet deep from its base to the top of the berm. It is a very large man-made structure. It is located almost entirely, if I'm not mistaken, this is sheet 8 of 24, partially It's located almost entirely in wetland soils, and it appears, as I say, there's no overlay, but appears to be partially in Sebago mucky peat. And it seems to me to dredge out hydric soils or to run bulldozers over them in order to create a man-made structure which will retain water, when in fact you're displacing soils which naturally detain water, is defeating the purpose of the stormwater detention and the protection of wetlands, which we are trying to assure through our ordinances. Finally, I would urge that the board prevent the acceptance of the community septic systems proposed for on lots 36 and 38. They are islands surrounded by wetland, and that is graphically shown on sheet 8. Here are the two white spaces with the multiple dots showing the test borings that were made for these community septic disposal areas. The dotted areas completely surrounding them are the hydric soils. That means, although, again, there's no overlay plan to show this, that the sewage pipes will be running under the water table at least part of the year in order to run sewerage out to these islands. And I suggest, both by the nature of the islands and by running sewage-carrying lines under the water table, that there are real potential health hazards to this community in approving that plan. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Monroe. Mr. Bruce, did you want to respond to some of these comments?
I would think that given the constraints of time and the volume of the material that was covered, that I would be inclined to respond only in a general way. I would disagree, of course, with much of what I heard, although it was a very thoughtful presentation, and Mr. Monroe has shown a keen interest in all of this. We can only rely upon the guidance of the statutes, the ordinances, various rules and regulations that are published and available to us, and of course the guidance of the staff, Steve Butler, Bob Hunter, and I presume that you're looking to the same people for guidance. I would hope that we have been in complete compliance and in all respects have followed the dictates of the law and of this board. So unless we want to go deeply into a rebuttal of these various points that have been brought up, I would be inclined to say only that we believe that we are in compliance. I will say that our vegetative analysis, which is not available to us at this moment but is being developed, could make some differences, and that's something that will be before you when we consider when you consider our application for alteration of wetlands, and that material will also be available to members of the public and Mr. Monroe as well. So aside from that, those general comments, I make no response. I will say one thing. I didn't realize that you had an opinion from, I presume it's Tom Leahy.
This is not written, but it certainly has been communicated to us, and I think we talked about that.
Yes, Steve is out of the room. Our attorneys have been in touch with Mr. Leahy to give him whatever sort of backup support. If he hasn't made a final decision on it, then we would hope that his opinion would be.
I think this is a matter for discussion, but we have been advised, not in written form yet, as I said.
But okay, but well,
and I think we asked that you perhaps talk with the town, the man who is in charge of the Department of Public Works on Chapter 15.
Oh, we have done that.
Which you have done.
Yes, we have done that, and we have. And our
realize the constraints of the sewer.
Oh yes, we understand that mm-hmm. there that But the approval of lots with a condition that they may not be built upon until town sewer is available, that's the
that
narrow
is the
question.
That is the point, and we should have a written opinion for you on that.
Okay.
But it has not been written yet. It's merely been via.
I hope, via, and I hope not cast in concrete in Tom's. Has he said that he will issue a written opinion that would not be permissible?
We will get one from him.
Okay.
I think it's more appropriate to have it in written form,
okay,
just to make things very clear.
Okay.
Any other comments, Mr. Bruce? Any other comments from members of the public or questions? If not, I will close the public portion of this hearing and open up for questions from the board or comments. I might just to help everybody understand where we are in the process, review where we are in the procedure. And Gulfcrest has gone through, they are a major subdivision. We have determined that their application is complete. 30 days from that, we are obligated through our ordinances to have a public hearing, which this is tonight. And then 30 days from that, the board will consider an approval of a preliminary plan or denial or approval with conditions of a preliminary plan. There are a number of And then 6 months from that, within 6 months, there must be a final plan submitted. So that is the process that a major subdivision does go through. I think there still are a number of issues that we need to address, and one of them, we often just update people on what some of the issues are before we meet formally and open the formal meeting, and that is where Ms. Monroe heard that we had heard from Mr. Leahy that those four lots were in question as far as even being considered. But we will get a written opinion on that from him. The issue of density, I think, needs to be addressed. We really don't know how you have calculated for the cluster system. What have you subtracted from roadways and buildings and so forth in order to arrive at a figure? We need to see those calculations written out and shown to us so that we know what we're talking about.
Those calculations are done in great detail and will be included in our July 1st package. But we can give them to you tonight.
Just as a reminder that needs to be addressed.
Yes, okay. We'll have those to you. And as Steve had said, don't file the stuff piecemeal.
Did you want to comment?
I might just add, if you have the figures here, it might be interesting just to see hear what they are.
Sure.
If you have them at your fingertips.
Okay, we'll do that. Well, Roland's fishing him out of his bag.
All right, well, then I'll just touch on some other issues that I think we need to discuss. I think we have heard in the public hearing that there are a lot of people who perhaps feel that a through road would be detrimental, that it could be a cutoff to the dump, and that they would be more in favor or more inclined to see a road that would have a crash gate or something even more terminal than its end. And I think the board needs to come to grips with that. We also have some information from town authorities as asked for and requested by Mr. Cross on correspondence from previous town officials, particularly the fire chief and police chiefs, about large subdivisions only having a single entrance access for reasons of safety primarily. We do have an ordinance that has not just a hundred, not just a 1,000-foot dead-end row, but 500 feet for a dead end. So that's something that would have to be waived, and if we were to consider this plan. I guess also it would be good to reference Mr. Hunter's letter of June 14th, which does refer to a lot of matters that I know you will be looking at in your next, for your next submissions. And the vegetation and wildlife report, we know, are coming in, and it's very important. We, as a planning board, we feel that this is will be very helpful in us considering wetlands alteration permit. We need to know both the soils, the drainage, the and the vegetation. It's very important for us to have that clearly marked out to see where the overlay is of the housing prints that relate to those delineations. You need to talk with the Conservation Commission further to get a view of the easements and the dedicated land and greenbelt and all of that, as well as their advice on the wetlands. We are, the Conservation Commission is advisory to the Planning Board, so it's important to have their input through you and to us. I do think we need to alert you to the need, the potential need for contacting the Army Corps of Engineers, not only the DEP, which I know you've already done, and as well as the local wetlands alteration permit. There is a requirement in a local wetlands alteration permit that there may be a public hearing with that, too. So that's quite likely that we would do that. I guess those perhaps are a list of some of the things I think we hope to look forward to seeing at the next submission time. And I wonder if any other board members have other thoughts or things that they would like to see in addition to those that I've just mentioned.
I'll start at the house. Mm-hmm. I did not make the sidewalk, so I'm not going to make any comments about the layouts and the lots and such. But there's one area that I have been concerned with, and from reading the correspondence from Bob Hunter, it does not seem to be, to me, that it's been properly taken care of, and that is the general subject of site distance at the entrance. Reading from Bob Hunter's letter to Jerry Daigle on June 14th, under item 24, page 3, the town ordinance requires an exiting site distance based on 7 seconds at the 85th speed percentile, or 110% of the posted speed. Based on his latter criteria, a site distance of 396 feet would be required. He reported the case that the proposed entrance only 33 feet is available. Mitigation of this deficiency should be investigated, and signing and lighting may not be sufficient. I noticed in one of your submissions, though, you noted 400 feet was available, according to the town's criteria for site distances. But even at that, you're pretty close to the limit. 396 is going to be awful hard to tell what 4 feet are. And I don't know whether that kind of accuracy was involved in your measurements. I just wonder if you can address that whole subject of site distances and what's been done to address this issue.
Yes, I'd be glad to do that. We did have the site distance measured by a registered surveyor. But in addition to that, Mr. Butler has asked that we lay out on the plan
right.
The actual site distances, show them laid out on the plan. The speed limit, I don't know if you were here when we discussed this, the speed limit actually now is posted at 35 miles an hour. So we do meet the requirements, but he wants it actually laid out so you can see the point in the road which satisfies the...
Has that been done with the drawings that we received?
No, it hasn't been in what you've received, but I think it's been done on what we'll be submitting by July 1st, if that's... Spurwood. The site distance.
If I could address that.
Like Joe was saying, the site distance was determined by Owen
Haskell. Excuse me, could you identify yourself?
My name is Roland Levesque. I'm a civil engineer at Whitman and Howard. And a site distance, safe stop and site distance was determined by Owen Haskell to be 400 feet, which is in more than the minimum requirements of ASHTO and the town ordinance. And we felt that that was more than sufficient for site distance on Spermick Avenue.
Curious, when that measurement was taken,
yes,
was vegetation considered?
Tell you quite honestly, I wasn't present for the site distance calculation. I believe Joe Bruce and Bob Hunter were present.
It has to be clear vegetation. You can move. There's a point you can. You don't have to be right at a particular point. There's a little leeway of, I think, 15 feet you can, from the edge of the road back, and if from anywhere in there, you can see along a line of sight of, I think, 396 feet. And,
Mr. Butler?
Madam Chairman, what we asked the applicant to do was really two things. One was to show on the plans both the horizontal and vertical sight distances from the proposed entrance road onto Spurwing. We also asked that those site distances be measured out in the field so that the police chief and town engineer, as well as planning board members, could go out there and yourself personally check those measurements. I'm assuming both items will be done.
Well, I was just asking about the vertical. Okay. And something, as far as submission is concerned, that will be, the change in the plan will be reflected in our submission that we make, or we'll put another plan in. I'm not sure just how Roland intends to comply with that, but we're mindful of that request.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? I would just like to add that I think in your wildlife report, if you can describe the wildlife impact, not just the deer, because wildlife means a lot more than just deer. It does mean bird life. And
I know that Mr. Lordy has...
He is addressing that.
Yeah, he has mentioned the various things that he's found out there, and some vegetation things, I believe, that he's commented on. But
any endangered species or...
Yes. But
furbish lousewats or what have you. Important to know.
Okay. I frankly don't... I just received the long form of it tonight, and I haven't had a chance to go over it myself, but I presume it covers it. Certainly includes all of his conclusions and findings. And,
Mr. Cross.
I share the concern that's been voiced tonight concerning the detention basins and the community septic systems down on lots 36 and 38, I believe they are. And If you could provide us a little bit more information and the overlay for the soils map showing the area of the detention basins, the two detention basins, and the three community septic systems, with particular emphasis on the ones on 36 and 38, just more information on them, because they're, from the information that we have, from the sidewalk that we took, they're very critical areas down in that area, and I would like to receive a little bit more information on those.
Okay, now as far as the community septic systems are concerned, those were designed by Mr. Frick, who is here tonight, and he can address those now if it's the type of thing that you can have orally. I know that at least his instructions were to be in absolute compliance with all the laws, and he's an expert, and you're all familiar with him, and we've seen him many times, but we are relying on Mr. Frick that those are adequate, in fact, more than adequate, to accommodate those systems.
If Mr. Frick, not necessarily tonight, but in your July submission, could address the issues that T.Y. Lynn raised in their letter dated June 14th.
That who raised
Hunter.
Mr.
Ballou.
Hunter.
Oh, okay, yes, all right.
Raised in his letter of June 14th.
All right, I don't see, where is this? Yeah, oh, okay, he's making a note of that, and we will provide him with that and have him respond to it as a part of our submission.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I did want to, before we go to other questions, I just would like to touch briefly on some of the comments that you made, Mrs. Rand. Some of the actual documents, like the conservation easements and the deed to the trust, have to go through a little process. We have to go to the attorney for the trust, and he'll look at them, and we'll submit them also to the Conservation Commission. And those will be approved and seen by these people. If they're not approved, they'll be changed. In the course of time between now and our final submission. But those, I wouldn't expect, would be ready by them. Mm-hmm. Okay, as long as we understand. And there may have been some other things on your list that are that we definitely have to deal with before you can give us final approval, but which we don't contemplate having before you in connection with the
But in order to speed the process along, I think it's well to be aware that there may be a lot of doing in order to get an application or to complete approval of an alteration of wetlands, that sort of thing.
Oh, we
and the DEP, and those all do have to be intact, and they may take a fair amount of time.
Yes, and I do, and you mentioned the Corps of Engineers. Now, we if we disturb, and I use that word, there's a long form for it, more than an acre of wetlands, then we have to go through a rather elaborate process with the Corps of Engineers. We believe, we have some preliminary measurements, that we are disturbing less than an acre of wetlands as they're defined. Now, there's several different definitions of wetlands. There's one for purposes of net residential acreage, there's others for purposes of the wetlands alteration permit. The DEP has now adopted a new one, and the Corps of Engineers has still another. And our detention basins enter into this as well. So to the extent that concerns have been raised about detention basins and the size of them, those are something that we have to clear with the Corps of Engineers or else go through their whole process. And it might, those measurements, and also this ruling that seems to have been made by town attorney might require some changes in our actual plan. I just mentioned that, and as we find out these things, the whole thing is in a state of flux throughout. I just want to
we appreciate that, and we are at a preliminary plan review status.
Okay, so
but I think it is well to be aware of what might be on down the road.
And we appreciate your suggestions. As a matter of fact, Steve has made some that we wouldn't have occurred to us, like the sidewalk waiver. And I presume you'll grant it, but if we don't ask for it, we can't get final approval. So,
Mr. Butler.
Just to reemphasize the point about the Army Corps approval, that the Army Corps looks at the wetlands to be impacted, not wetlands to be altered, so that if what you're going to do, even if it takes up a quarter of an acre, if it's going to impact a wetland that's greater than an acre in size downstream even, then it will come into review. So
that's why these detention basins and all enter into the measurements. But those are things that we're going to have to address, and they could cause a great hiatus at some point. If we run into that kind of a snag, we may have to make some substantial changes in our approach.
Fine. Are there any other questions or comments from board members? If not, we thank you very much for your very full explanation and also from the full testimony from abutters and neighbors.
I'm still in default slightly. You wanted me to review the net residential acreage calculation.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I guess. Do you have a...
Good evening. My name is Roland Levesque. I'm a civil engineer at Whitman and Howard, and I'd like to go quickly through the net residential calculations. To first start out, the gross available acreage is approximately 112.34 acres. The 15% for roads and parking is approximately 16.85 acres. Item 2, which addresses land cut off by a major barrier or a major stream, is approximately 13.23 acres.
Did you say 13?
Yes. Okay, under item 4, areas unsuitable for development, it's approximately half an acre for bedrock at the surface, or is within 6 inches. For slopes in excess of 15%, approximately 2.04 acres. Water table at the surface for all or part of the year is 0.8 acres. Land and rights of way or easements is approximately 0.08 acres. And the Resource Protection District, which also takes into account the Sebago Muckey Peak of item 4 under item 4, is approximately 18.56 acres. And that comes out to approximately 60.28 acres multiplied by 0.66. Comes out to about 39.8 units.
Thank you. Is that in our, will you put that in our?
Yes, I will, so for next Friday's submission.
Great.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments? If not, one more public comment.
I just have a question, which is the 18.56 acres, which is based on resource protection,
Sebago Muckey Peaks, actually the line delineated by the town covers soils which aren't actually Sebago Muckey Peaks. To be conservative, we included the whole area as delineated by the town. So actually, if we really wanted to, there's less Sebago Muckey Peaks than the Resource Protection District line shows, but we included the whole line delineated by the town. Well, that area that you just pointed to, Mr. Monroe, is an area that we considered, it's area that's cut off by a major stream or barrier, which is 13.23 acres.
Mr. Bruce?
Just want to add very quickly that again, I want to emphasize that we have not responded to Mr. Monroe's comments. He made some comments about Sebago Muckey Peak that has been measured, not only for very conservatively, as Mr. Levesque just mentioned, and very precisely, is very precisely shown on our soils evaluation. Also, the comments about the detention basin and all, I have not responded to those. I rely on my general comment against that.
I suspect we'll see you in July.
I suspect so. Have we?
And the submission date for that.